Thank you both. Thank you for the invitation to give this presentation. Atrial fibrillation and stroke. And what I'm going to discuss today with you is stroke. How big actually is the problem for patients with atrial fibrillation? Does rhythm control, a strategy that aims to abolish atrial fibrillation, is effective for prevention of stroke? And then I'm going to discuss with you an important issue. Is atrial fibrillation actually relevant for stroke? Is it a mechanism or is it just a bystander? And finally, I'll show you that atrial fibrillation, you all know, is a progressive disease and that once AF progression occurs, that is associated with an increase in stroke, heart failure, and mortality. Well, first, stroke. What actually is the problem in patients with atrial fibrillation? This is a quite recent study being performed in GP practices in the UK. And note that about 87% of these patients, patients who were included were white, so there's always a difference between races. Over 4 million adults were included, and outcome was assessed, and the EKG and the presence of atrial fibrillation was assessed, and the outcome was assessed by linkage with secondary care data. And as you can see very clearly, those who developed atrial fibrillation has a hazard ratio of 2.7, so more than 2.5 times increased risk of stroke once they developed atrial fibrillation. So, and other vascular diseases also showed an increased hazard ratio in those adults who developed atrial fibrillation during a follow-up of only 7 years. So stroke still is a huge problem in atrial fibrillation. And that was also affirmed by this registry, also a very large registry being chaired by Jeff Healy, the RELY registry. Over 47 countries, including over 50,000 atrial fibrillation. And those patients were only included when they were admitted to the emergency department. Only 1 year of follow-up. And during that year, only 1 year, more than 10% died. 6% with primary AF. So they came to the emergency room because of the arrhythmia. And 16% in patients with secondary AF. Of course, those patients had atrial fibrillation in the setting, e.g. of acute heart failure, an acute ischemic event, or other diseases. And during that year, 4% of the patients had a stroke. And that was not different between the primary and the secondary AF patients. And note the enormous difference between the countries and also, of course, then because between the races. And note the low risk of stroke, for example, in India, and the high risk of stroke in Africa. So a huge problem. Well, is rhythm control effective? Does abolishing atrial fibrillation prevent stroke? Well, you all know, and it is already more than 15 years ago, that the first rate versus rhythm control trial started. And a lot of has been changed during those years in treatments for patients with atrial fibrillation. That's the reason why, that's among one of the reasons why I show you the last one, but that is already also 10 years old. That was the only trial being performed in patients with heart failure, the AF-CHF trial. And as you can see, death from any cause, worsening of heart failure and the composite outcome, but also stroke, the occurrence of stroke during follow-up, over 2 years of follow-up, was not different. And of course, that was being caused at least in part because rhythm control at that time and patients with heart failure, but also in the other trials, AFFIRM, RACE and the others, was very difficult. And you all know that sinus rhythm maintenance is very difficult in all our patients. And that is why we urgently await two trials now going on, CABANA and the most important one, in my view, because of the study interventions, and the number, the people who are included in that trial is the EAST trial. It's a European trial being chaired, amongst others, by Paulus Kirchhoff and also John Kemp, who is here today. And what's new and what's different in the EAST trial? Well, for example, that they included patients with early onset atrial fibrillation, so the chance to restore and maintain sinus rhythm is higher in that as compared to those older trials. And the strategies are different. In the early rhythm control trial, patients with early AF are included early after onset of atrial fibrillation, and also it is intended to perform a pulmonary vein isolation early after start. And as you know, pulmonary vein isolation is much more affected nowadays as 10 or 15 years ago. And the other patients are treated with usual care, which in fact means rate control. So again, a new rate and rhythm control trial. And we have to await this trial, the results of this trial, as well as the Cabana trial, whether abolishing atrial fibrillation is effective to prevent stroke. But the idea whether atrial fibrillation is indeed involved, is a mechanism or just a marker of stroke, well, that is still a matter of a lot of discussion. As you can see on the right-hand side, and I often show this slide, it comes from a paper of Mike Ezekowitz, showing you in panel A the thrombus in the left atrial appendage, and then some minutes later it is in the left atrium, and that woman developed a stroke several hours later. Luckily, this was seen, so she was treated not by an acute intervention because it was 10 years ago, but she was treated with anticoagulation. But what I want to show you is that there is now a lot of evidence that there is not a real connection between atrial fibrillation and stroke. These are data from ASSERT, but the same come from other trials. And as you can see here, the stroke is here in the middle. This is the time the patients were monitored with an atrial lead, either a pacemaker or by an ICD, 1 year before until 1 year after. The gray zones are the time that they were monitored. And as you can see here, the red arrows, very small and short episodes of atrial fibrillation, but occurring long before the stroke. Here, a patient with persistent atrial fibrillation, and again, as you can see, long before the stroke. And the same was true here for all these patients. In these patients, atrial fibrillation did occur only after the stroke. And only in a few, the stroke really was preceded by atrial fibrillation. So whether atrial fibrillation itself was really a mechanism, was involved in the stroke, is still a matter of discussion. So the SCAF episodes are associated, but only a minority of the patients had SCAF in the months. This was all subclinical atrial fibrillation, that's SCAF, what SCAF means, in the month before the stroke. So the idea about how atrial fibrillation can be involved in stroke is very complicated. And this is just an idea that atrial fibrillation very often occurs in patients with vascular risk factors. Actually, we wrote a paper that lone atrial fibrillation nowadays almost does not exist. So there are patients with vascular risk factors, for example, hypertension, who develop an atrial myopathy, which means structural remodeling in the atrium, enlarged left atrial size. By their risk factors, hypertension, they may develop atrial fibrillation, and that chance is even higher in the presence of an atrial myopathy. Due to vascular risk factors, atrial myopathy develops, but also hypercoagulability and other remodeling processes, setting the stage for stroke. So stroke may occur by the atrial myopathy, by hypercoagulability and other mechanisms, and also by atrial fibrillation. And indeed, it is a vicious circle because atrial fibrillation deteriorates the atrial myopathy, further enlarge the atrial size and increase structure remodeling processes. And the atrial myopathy increases hypercoagulability and other mechanisms like inflammation and whatsoever. And finally, once stroke and AF progression occurs, atrial fibrillation also deteriorates into more progressive and permanent forms of atrial fibrillation. So the association between atrial fibrillation and stroke, in my and in our view, is really complicated. And it is still a question whether AF is the mechanism or just a marker, a bystander. Well, one of the problems of atrial fibrillation is that it is a progressive disease, and that once AF progression develops, more morbidity and mortality occurs. And that it is a progressive disease comes from data, especially the first, among the first ones showing that was the Euro Heart Survey, the atrial fibrillation Euro Heart Survey. And they looked only for 1 year, and during that 1 year, 50% of the patients deteriorated from paroxysmal atrial fibrillation in more permanent forms atrial fibrillation. And that number actually, and that is almost the same, that number is almost the percentage of patients who show AF progression. In a lot of AF studies being performed nowadays, is almost always 15% per year. So that is a lot. And as you can see here, indeed, once patients develop AF progression, then the cardiovascular admissions, but also the stroke rate, enormously increase. So in fact, what we have to do is to prevent all those vascular risk factors, and probably also in that way atrial fibrillation, and in that way we may also prevent stroke. So. And it is not only for clinical AF, it is also for subclinical AF. This, again, is the ASSERT study in which patients with pacemakers were included. And as you can see, the patients who develop subclinical AF showed a 2.5-time increased risk of an ischemic stroke of systemic embolism. And that particularly occurred in those with longer lasting AF, so with more progressive subclinical AF. So, Mr. Chairman, Mrs. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, in conclusion, stroke is an enormous problem in atrial fibrillation, but I also want to stress it is not only stroke. Nowadays, my presentation, our council, is not about heart failure, but heart failure also is a huge problem in atrial fibrillation. The mechanisms of stroke and atrial fibrillation still not completely known, whether atrial fibrillation is really a mechanism or a bystander. Anyway, AF often increases the risk and is associated with an increased risk of stroke. Thank you for your attention.
So we have some minutes for discussion. If you have any questions.
On a Holter monitor, when you see irregularity of the heart, what is the shortest or longest duration of the irregularity you see, which you'll call AFib?
Okay, that's a very important question. Thank you for that. So in our guidelines, in the atrial fibrillation guidelines, atrial fibrillation should be documented on an EKG, and it should last for 30 seconds if you have it on a Holter monitoring. Now, with the subclinical atrial fibrillation issue, a lot of discussion is going on when to anticoagulate those patients. Is 5 minutes or 6 minutes, like in the ASSERT trial, enough? Well, for example, Professor Kam wrote a nice paper about it. And once you see subclinical AF and it lasts shorter than 24 hours, you have to document it on EKG and not just on the atrial lead as a high atrial rate episode. So for clinical AF, 30 seconds documented on the EKG. For subclinical AF, lasting more than 24 hours, then it is really atrial fibrillation. You should anticoagulate. And of course, 24 hours, well, 23. I would also anticoagulate my patients, but 5-6 minutes. The trials are going on. There are two large trials now assessing that issue, the Artesia and the NOAA. But if you see a high rate atrial episodes or subclinical AF, then you have to try to document it. So be keen on that in all patients with vascular diseases. And later today or tomorrow, I will have a presentation about the risk of AF in patients with higher chest vascular scores.